Welcome to the exclusive interview with Elizabeth Wein for Books.com, an online convention about books, stories, and everything writing related. Thank you for doing this, Elizabeth.
You're very welcome. I'm sorry it's just an interview and that I'm not actually helping you out in the workshops as well.
But the interview is already amazing, and really thank you for this opportunity. Well, let's start at the beginning. How did you become a writer? Was it something you've always wanted, or did it happen by chance?
It really didn't happen by chance. It is something that I have been working at for a long time. And this story, every time I tell this story, it sounds a little bit cheesier, but it's a true story. And I was about 7 years old. I was living in Jamaica, and I was having the reading breakthrough that a lot of people have when they realize that they can read, and this kind of opens up a big world to them. And my grandmother, who lived in the United States, sent me a book every month. She called it the Book of the Month Club. Mm-hmm. And some of the books that she sent were books that had belonged to my mother and my aunts when they were little. And indeed, some of them had belonged to my grandmother when she was a small girl. And some of them were new. And she had sent me a copy of Ellen Tebbit's by Beverly Cleary, who is the author of the Ramona books. That's what everybody really knows her for. But the book that she sent was Ellen Tebbit's, and I read it in one sitting. So it was the first time I ever read a chapter book, you know, proper book, you know, that wasn't really supposed to be a picture book, from cover to cover in one sitting. And I was seven, and I was really proud of myself. And I closed this book and I thought, I want to write books just like this. And that was kind of the beginning of it. And my best friend at the time and I started writing a series of books that were based on the Hardy Boys, except they were girls. We didn't read Nancy Drew, we just read the Hardy Boys. And so these were the Churcha girls. And of course they were starring us as Claire and Linda. And we kind of wrote a lot of Laura Ingalls Wilder fan fiction. We wrote these like episodes where they would get attacked by crocodiles in the river and have, you know, various we weren't likely to have out on the prairie in South Dakota. And we wrote a lot of stuff. And I continued to write all through my childhood. I wrote a novel when I was 11. I decided I was going to write a full-length book, and I sat down and I wrote 5 pages a day.
Wow.
Every day for 3 months.
Nice.
And I've never been this productive again ever in my life. But I sat down and I did it, and my mother typed it up for me, and the completed manuscript is like 90 typed pages.
Wow.
It was a time travel story. It was called Lorna and Anna.
Nice.
And I wrote another book when I was 15. These are all like, you'll never read these because they're just
they're hidden away.
Yeah. I wrote another book when I was 15, which was called By Sunlight and Starlight, and it was epic fantasy, and it was really not very good. But it was when I was 15. By that time I was really focused. I knew I wanted to be a writer. I wanted to go to university and study English or writing or something like that, which is what I did. And I, at that point, got heavily into Arthurian literature and mythology and Celtic mythology. And so the beginnings of what eventually became my first novel were planted when I was 15. I had already made up the characters. Well, I didn't make them up because essentially it's Arthurian fan fiction. But the characters were forming in my head while I was still in school. And it took 10 years for them to fully develop and me to come around to actually writing something that was a manuscript worth publishing using those characters. Mm-hmm. But it's definitely been a process that's been going on, you know, since I was 7 years old when I first learned to read. Mm-hmm.
Speaking of your first manuscript, what about querying and finding an agent? Did you find one with your first submission? How has the whole process?
Well, I would say that I have never successfully submitted anything cold. That this belies what I'm about to say next, which is that I've been very, very lucky in submitting stuff. The reason I would say I've not submitted anything cold is because I've always known somebody. And single successful submission that I've ever had has been because I knew somebody. So with The Winter Prince, my first book, I was working on it while I was at university. And I did a semester in London, and my roommate was a woman named Catherine Kirkpatrick, who also writes young adult novels. Neither one of us had written anything at that point, but we, you know, bonded and decided that we wanted to share a room based on the fact that we both wanted to write children's literature. And she became, and still is, a very good friend of mine. She went another route for me. I decided I was going to go and do postgraduate studies in folklore and mythology, and that was, you know, sort of my way to getting to know my literature. Mm-hmm. She went the sort of, you know, total immersion route into publishing, and so when she finished university, she went to work for as an editorial assistant at a publishing company in New York. But I knew her, and so when I had something that was manuscript ready, I sent it to her. And she gave it to someone she knew. Okay. And it was, and that was the manuscript for The Winter Prince. And it wasn't, you know, it wasn't immediately taken. It wasn't like I had an instant sale, but people were interested in it. They had some suggestions for it. They came back to me right away. To put this in perspective, this was in like, man, it was like 1990. It was a long time ago. And it was really pre-internet. I mean, the internet was in its infancy. And everything was still done very traditionally by mail, by snail mail. Mm-hmm. You sent a full paper printed manuscript with a self-addressed envelope and a printed out cover letter, and you waited 6 months.
You couldn't refresh your email constantly.
No. Eventually the whole thing came back to you. And you couldn't call. I mean, it was really not the done thing to contact people once you'd submitted this manuscript. You know, you waited. So eventually that manuscript, and you know, at the time it was a pretty quick turnaround. Eventually I rewrote that manuscript and submitted it to the same editor that my friend Catherine had suggested, and she took it. I did not have an agent. Never remember how much I actually sold it for, but it was in the region of $3,000-$4,000. Okay. It probably would have been a bit more if I'd had an agent, but not substantially more for the time, I think. And that was the Winter Prince. There's a 10-year gap between when I sold The Winter Prince and when I sold my next book, A Coalition of Lions. And all kinds of things happened during that 10 years. I got my PhD in folklore, and I got married, and I moved to the United Kingdom, and I had a baby, and, you know, and I wrote another manuscript that wasn't published and still isn't published. So lots and lots of things happened. And by the time I wrote A Coalition of Lions, 10 years had passed. And what happened with that was I had been very heavily involved in the Society for Children's Book Writers, mm-hmm. and Illustrators. And still am, although I'm not working, I'm not doing as much volunteer work for them as I did in the mid-90s. And through them, I invited Robin McKinley, who is a fantasy writer, and she's won the Newbery Award, and she lives in the United Kingdom, as do I, but she's American. And so we kind of had a little bit in common. And she and I got her to come and speak at one of our Society of Children's Book Writers and Illustrators meetings. And we became friendly, and she introduced me to Sharon November, who eventually became my editor at Viking for many years. And it was also through Robin McKinley that I got my agent, because she, her agent, Marilee Heifetz, was my agent's boss at the time.
Okay.
And so my agent, Ginger Clark, was just starting out, kind of, you know, taking some clients of her own. I think I was one of her first two clients. And I might have been her first sale and not her first client, or it's the other way around. But she's now independent and very well respected. But at the time, you know, she was just starting out. Mm-hmm. And so was I. And so Robin suggested that I had a manuscript that she might be interested in. And that was kind of how I ended up with Ginger as my agent. But this is all of it is through knowing somebody or being in touch with someone. And that is part of it is coincidence. So like it was coincidence that me and Catherine Kirkpatrick came together. But she was, you know, way down on the totem pole when she started as an editorial assistant in New York. And it was really through reaching out and doing volunteer work for I'm going to say SCBWI because that's easier to say than society.
Yes.
It was doing volunteer work for them that got me in touch with Robin McKinley, who put me in touch with Ginger Clark and Sharon November. And it was going to conventions. I went to a lot of science fiction and fantasy conventions in the 90s. And going there helped me meet people and talk to people. Short story sales happened because I met people at conventions. And so it's really, it's not like it's luck that you end up meeting these people. You put yourself out there and you meet people and you introduce yourself to people. And that's really, really, I think, you know, if anyone's looking for advice into how to get into the industry, how to get published, it's really to make contacts. Partly, you know, by doing things like what you're doing, you know, organizing a conference is a fantastic way to do this.
Thank you.
but yeah, it's so much easier nowadays, of course, because you can talk to people on Twitter and it can be very informal and, you know, you can send them a message on Facebook. You can comment on their blog. It's just, it's easier to reach out to people. And I think everybody feels less, it's a more open industry than it used to be when you sat there for 6 months waiting for somebody to.
Yeah, and I agree. There's more opportunities too, like an online convention, you know, because some people can't go to all the conventions. And then online one and Twitter, it's great to meet new people, writers, agents, editors, publishers. It's amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, so for those who don't know your books, what can you tell us about them? The first ones, the recent ones, show us a little, some covers.
Okay, so I talked a lot about The Winter Prince, my first book. And so here it is.
Let's see if we
can get that, so yeah. It's not too glary looking. This is the original cover for The Winter Prince, which I was absolutely thrilled with.
Yeah,
mainly because I really loved the way it makes the characters look, and I can kind of show you all sorts of, it's a little glary there, isn't it?
Yeah, I can see it.
Okay. All kinds of subtle things going on, like, so Medrot, this guy, is on the defensive, his sword is sort of on top, it's not a defensive offense, you know, he's the attacker, his sword is kind of on top there, and he's, in a more defensive position, and there were sort of more things going on that I kind of forget at the time. There's like little phoenixes going up the side, which I thought were very cool, and I really liked the way this character, who was kind of the darling of my heart, but is also a pain in the neck. I liked the way
that's always.
So yes, anyway, oh yes, and I know what it was that I liked. I liked that he had this little kind of crown headband and he didn't, you know, because that was appropriate too. So yeah, this is The Winter Prince, which is based, this is my first book anybody out there who thinks that Codename Verity is my first book, this was my first book. It was published in 1993. Okay? 20 years, almost 20 years before Codename Verity. Yep. Codename Verity was not a 9 days wonder. A lot of people think it is this amazing debut novel. No, it's the result of many years of work and of maturity. I just have to add that in there too.
Yes.
So The Winter Prince was really sort of, it was written because I was passionately into Arthurian legend. It's told in this weird style, actually. It's in the second person. The narrator is actually talking to his mother, who has a very strange relationship with. And he tells the story to her. He's called Medra in the book, but he's actually King Arthur's illegitimate son, Mordred. So that's the sort of basis. And the story he tells is about his relationship with his legitimate half-siblings, who are twins. And I made them up. They're original characters who don't exist in the Arthurian canon. And their names are Clé, which is how you pronounce his weird Welsh name, because he's based on he's based on Welsh mythology, and Gawain, his twin sister. And I discovered when I was about, oh, I don't know, it's deeply embroiled in creating this story. I discovered that there is actually a character who, in Welsh legend, who is a counterpart of Clé, who really does exist. His name is Clache, but it kind of means the same thing as Clé, which is bright one. And he has a French counterpart in medieval French Arthurian romance as Lohold. And in fact, in the French translation of The Winter Prince, they call Clé Lohold. They actually went and tracked this guy down and gave him that name. So it's like, I didn't even make him up, but I did make him up. So that was weird. So when I wrote this book, you know, this is like the book that you passionately write when you're 19 years old, you know, and it just like colors everything that you think about, and you're so into the characters and everything. And the other books, the books that I've written since then have actually taken a lot more time to research. There's no actual fantasy in that, but because it's based on Arthurian legend, it just feels like fantasy. And I considered myself a fantasy writer when I wrote it. And what came up 10 years later was this, which is actually a sequel of sorts. It's called A Coalition of Lions. And in The Winter Prince, this one is about Gawain, okay? So this is about the twin sister from the previous book. And in The Winter Prince, I had been, early on, it bothered me that it was just such a white people's book. And, you know, it had to be because it was set in Arthurian Britain. It was, you know, set in 6th century in Britain. And I wanted just to add to it the notion that it wasn't the only place in the whole world that existed. And so I got the idea that I would give Medra, the main character, a past that had involved traveling to somewhere where there was a bit more diversity. And I asked my uncle, Roger Whitaker, who had been in the Peace Corps in Ethiopia in the 60s, if he knew of any. I think I gave him a bunch of criteria, and it was a 6th century Middle Eastern or North African country that preferably had been Christian, because then it would make more sense for my Arthurian people to have some kind of cultural exchange with them. And he said, oh yes, the kingdom of Aksum in Ethiopia was one of the great kingdoms, one of the great civilizations of the world in the 6th century. And, you know, not many people know about this, but yeah, he could, you know, he could have been there as an ambassador. He could have had a girlfriend there. And I was like, right, that sounds great. And I did a little bit of research and included her. There's reference made to it in the Winter Prince, just to kind of give people like an idea that, like, you know, sort of Britain is not the center of the universe. There are other places out there. Mm-hmm. And so for a coalition of lions, I actually set the book in Aksum, in Ethiopia, in the 6th century. And part of the reason it took me so long to write is because I didn't know anything about it. And I had to, you know, just do all that research from scratch. There was a point in 1997 or so where I thought I probably was the one of like 20 people in the world who knew as much as I knew about this country. I've forgotten most of it now because I'm not a historian and I'm not a, you know, I'm not an antiquities scholar. And I kind of move on from interest to interest. And I have forgotten a lot of it, but I really worked hard at trying to get this right. So A Coalition of Lions is about King Arthur's daughter going to Ethiopia, meeting people there. She kind of falls in love there with one of the Ethiopian nobles. She gets involved in political intrigue. It's a very different book from The Winter Prince. Mm-hmm. And some people tend to like, the same people don't like both. You see what I mean?
Yes, yes.
The one is more of a boy book and the other is more of a girl book.
Boy book and girl book.
Quotes.
Quotes.
So there's a kid in A Coalition of Lions, this 6-year-old kid whose picture is here in the side, that's him.
Okay.
His name is Telemachus, and he first turns up in this book at the age of 6. He is the son of Medrot, King Arthur's son, and a noblewoman from Aksum, whose name is Tarunish. She was mentioned in The Winter Prince. He didn't know that this kid existed because he went away before he was born. But the next 3 books are about Telemachus, who just like ate my soul for many years. So there are 3 about Telemachus, and he's older, obviously, in these. The Sunbird, The Lion Hunter, and The Empty Kingdom. And he's like 10 when The Sunbird starts, and he's, how old is he? Something like 13 or 14.
Okay.
When The Empty Kingdom ends, 15, I can't remember. But it sort of follows his growing up. And they're all set in Aksum, and a bit are set in Southern Arabia because that was part of the Aksumite Empire at the time. Some of them have like, there's like no white characters in this book. And actually, I really, really love the cover of this one. I don't know if you can see Telemachus in this.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Because this is kind of, you know, this was published in 2008, and it was really before diversity had become something that people talked about.
Yes.
In children's books. And a lot of people say, you know, oh, they whitewash all the characters. I mean, they do whitewash characters. People don't just say it. They do whitewash pictures of characters on the covers of books. This guy is not whitewashed.
Yep.
This is, you know, what he looks like. And sometimes I think that maybe that's one of the reasons nobody has paid attention to these books.
Could be. unfortunately, it could be true.
You know, and they were reviewed well. People who know them absolutely love them. The Sunbird, I would say, may be the best book I've ever written. And anybody who loves Codename Verity, which is what I'm known for, spy book will probably also love The Sunbird, which was my first spy book. So, yeah. Now, the books that you have there, which I don't have copies of, just
I have standing up here.
Like me. Incidentally, all my early books, okay? So for anybody listening who's still listening, who's interested, all the Arthurian books are all available from Open Road as ebooks now. They're out of print in paper, but you can buy them as ebooks and you can find them used in paper. You prefer that. What was I going to say? Oh yeah. So Codename Verity. So then I had this kind of like hiatus where I was writing another book, which still remains unpublished. It was another book about Telemachus. And my editor asked me if I would try to write something more mainstream. I've been writing short stories the whole time, and I'd written one about this girl pilot who I got my pilot's license in 2003, and I became kind of obsessed with flying with aircraft about the same time. And I wrote several short stories, all of which are published, about flying. And I wrote a story about a girl who disguises herself as her dead brother and becomes a pilot in the Battle of Britain. And so my editor said, can you write something maybe, you know, a bit more like that? And Codename Verity is what came out. And it really did just come pouring out. It was like, it was time. I was ready to write this book. And surprisingly, because, you know, I'd just written four books, counting the one that's not published, about a boy, and another one about a different boy, and one that was about a girl. And suddenly I was writing this book about girls, and like it was a really, really feminist book as well. And I don't know where that came from. The only thing there are two things I think that maybe were feeding into it. One is that I just became aware as I was learning to fly myself, how unusual it was. Where were all the other women learning to fly? Because there was no reason why there shouldn't have been any there, but there weren't any on the airfield. There was a woman who was an instructor, and there was another woman who had a pilot's license already, but she was not a student. There were no other female students in the flying club where I was learning to fly. And I just thought, like, what the heck? And I became interested in the history of women aviators. And so, and as I say, Codename Verity is what came out. The other thing I think that really influenced me turning this into such a, you know, kind of feminist propaganda piece, if you want to call it like that, is that I had, at the time I was writing it, I had a 12-year-old daughter, which is now 18. But all of a sudden, all these issues, things that I had felt were kind of handed to me and were easy for me to deal with, and things that I thought had changed from the time I was a child, it seemed like we were going backwards. And I was seeing what a struggle it was for my daughter to, you know, the pressure that she got to wear the right kind of underwear because people would laugh at her when she changed for gym class, you know, this kind of thing. It was just like, oh my God, are we still doing this? So there was that, me just being more aware of battles that are yet to be won. And then when I was working on the book itself, it turned so into this celebration of friendship. And while I was writing the book, I really wasn't thinking about it being a feminist manifesto. I was not focused on that. I was focused on the relationship between the characters. And one of the things that I realized in writing Codename Verity was that I was going to have to make the characters best friends in order for the plot to work. Mm-hmm. So once I realized that, I just sort of sat down and said, okay, well, let's have fun with them. You know, let's create a little friendship for them. And that was so much fun to do because I just sort of, you know, thought about all the good times I'd had with my friends and the way it had felt making friends with my friends and things that we had to deal with together and this kind of stuff, and just poured it all into the book. And yeah, Codename Verity is what came out. And so you were holding that up, hold that up again.
Yep, let me, here they are, the paperback and the hardcover.
Okay, so what she's got there is the British paperback, Code Name Verity, and then the other one with the bound hands, that's actually the Canadian hardcover. It looks very similar to the USA hardcover. But there's many, many different covers available, many different, it's actually available in many different languages. So if you have people mm-hmm. listening from non-English speaking countries, it may well be available in your own language. Mm-hmm. So, and then I have two more books out after Codename Verity, Rose Under Fire, which is a, and there we have the US cover and the UK cover. And so the US one is in hardback, but it's also available in paperback as well. It's got a different cover in paperback. And Rose Under Fire kind of follows on chronologically from Codename Verity, but it's not really about the same people. It shares a few characters with Codename Verity. It's a new and different story. And I didn't actually say anything about what Codename Verity was about, but it takes place during World War II and it has a pilot and a spy in it. And Rose Under Fire has another pilot, all women pilots. And she ends up being interred in the camp at Ravensbrück, north of Germany. And so it's very much about Ravensbrück and what went on there. And it is the story that is really the most true. It was kind of the one that I felt like, okay, I have something that needs to be told here. So everything that happens in the concentration camp is true. You know, it happens to fictional characters in my book, but I didn't make it up. And then the most recent book that I have published is Black Dove, White Raven. And that is the US cover. Can you hold it up just a little bit so you can see the people at the bottom? No, not forward, just up. There we go. So now we've got these two characters walking along the road there. And they are an adopted brother and sister who both learn to fly. And so kind of what Black Dove, White Raven takes place in Ethiopia in 1935. So it's like I've combined my two interests, flying and Ethiopia, and brought them together. And that's that one. But the books definitely separate into the Arthurian books and the flying books. So depending on what you're interested in, you know, try either or.
Exactly.
Most of them stand on their own. They're all loosely connected in series, but most of them can be picked up on their own.
Okay. And why those particular historical eras, the Arthurian ones and World War II, by the way?
Well, I don't know why I became so, you know, I was a King Arthur fangirl, so that's why Arthurian. And Aksum, you know, was the kingdom of Aksum was chronologically, it coincided with Arthurian Britain. Aksum actually was around for 600 years. It was a well-established kingdom, if you could call it an empire. The time period around when the historical Arthur existed was an interesting time period in the history of Aksum. And there is actually, because they had a coinage very early on, you can trace the kingship. You can tell when the country became Christian. There's quite a bit written about it in ancient times. And there's been quite a lot of archaeological research done on it. So there was a lot to draw on there. But it was really probably, if it hadn't been coincidental with the Arthurian stuff, I wouldn't have written about it. But then of course there's also my family connection, because my aunt and uncle were in the Peace Corps there, so that's why I was interested in Ethiopia. Flying again was because I did it. It was a thing that I was interested in because I was doing it. I got my pilot's license because I'm married to a man who has his private pilot's license. And so that sort of made me go, okay, well, yeah, that's pretty cool. I love flying around with you. I'd like to be able to do this myself. So that's why it's pretty straightforward. And the Arthurian really just dates back to me being obsessed with King Arthur as a teenager.
Understandable. Yeah. You've spoken about it a little, but clearly this involves doing a lot of research to make sure it's accurate as possible, historically and culturally. What's your general process, and what do you think people should do when writing historical novels such as yours, or novels in other countries?
It's really changed a lot. My process has changed over the years because, like with The Winter Prince, I didn't do that much research for it. I read so much it just sort of soaked in. I did a little bit of research into kind of Roman Britain, but really nothing near to do now. And I think what is expected of me now with the Ethiopian novels, I did much more research. So I went to this was in the 1990s. So my research worked differently than it does now. And for those books, I actually went to the library. I was living in England and I went to the Bodleian Library like every day of the week and sat in the reading rooms there reading everything that any scholar had ever written on Aksum. And that's really what I did. I just sat there taking notes and reading everything that had ever been written on this topic. And I guess because it's such an obscure topic, I was actually able to do that. I think that with World War II, there's no chance you'll ever be able to read everything that's ever
true.
But that's how I researched those books. One of the things that I did when I was researching Ethiopia. And actually, this is something that I do no matter what I'm researching. I always work with a map. I don't know. I'm kind of obsessed with maps. And most pilots are, but I was obsessed with maps before I became a pilot. So this is what I have here is a flight map for northern Ethiopia.
Okay.
And this map was see if I can fold it down so you can get a better look. This is the map that I used to write The Sunbird and A Coalition of Lions. And I don't know if you can see, but there are annotations all over it. Yeah. And so this is actually Eritrea you're looking at, which is the country just north of Ethiopia. Because the Kingdom of Aksum included what is now modern Ethiopia and Eritrea. And these notes were all me like sticking the ancient known towns of Aksum in there. This note says, this road is inaccessible due to disrepair and mines. Sigh. Yeah. Sorry.
No problem.
If there was anything else interesting to read there. So I mean, I hadn't been to Ethiopia when I wrote these books. I have now. But one of the ways that I tried to immerse myself in the country, and this was even for the ones that were set in the 6th century, was very straightforward guidebooks. Okay. So this one is a Spectrum Guide to Ethiopia. This is my favorite one. And the reason it's my favorite is because it has really, really beautiful pictures. And what you're looking at there, which I just happened to open it to, is the temple where the Ark of the Covenant is.
Oh, nice.
Supposed to be kept. Amazing. In the modern city of Aksum, mm-hmm. which is a feature in Black Dove, White Raven, just saying. and so this book and this is another picture of the necropolis at Aksum. These are
amazing
graves which are date to about the well to the 6th century, some of them, but many of them are earlier than that, but they would have been standing at the time that my books take place. And so this book was just, it shows like different dress and hairstyles and talks about food. It has, I've still got like my old page points in it. See this little thingy? Mm-hmm. It's a little copper page point somebody gave me. And the reason, I don't know why it's actually open to this page, but the bit I've underlined says, is under visiting a church, and it says, if you wish to attend a service, you're expected not to eat beforehand. Both men and women are expected to wear clothing that covers their body completely, and it is preferred if women cover their heads. So this kind of thing, you know, these like little cultural things that you wouldn't necessarily know if you weren't there at that country. And indeed, even if you were there and you weren't paying attention, I really have found, this is not the only guidebook I've read, but I found that travel guides are actually a really, really good way of immersing yourself in an unfamiliar culture. And of course, to visit the country as well, which I've also done, and talk to people from that country. So that's one thing. For World War II, it's actually, it's easier to do the research because there's so much of it. So I used maps as well. Oh, I have, this is an exciting thing. Somebody gave me this because they knew I was interested in maps. And it is, it belonged to the father of a friend of ours who, when he was in the Royal Air Force during, and it is a road atlas.
Oh,
okay. Nice. Just a road atlas, but it's issued during the war. So it's kind of, you know, restricted stuff. And that's what it looks like. That's what the whole book looks like. You know, it's just the whole of Britain. Mm-hmm. But it's really, really useful if you want to know what roads there were in Britain, you know, during 1943. It was published in 1940, but probably still in use in 43. And this was the real thing. This is a facsimile, but this is air transport auxiliary ferry pilot's notes. And I'm holding it up so you can see it there. Mm-hmm. But if I sort of hold it up to my head, you'll see the actual size it is. It's index card sized, and it's spiral bound, ring bound, so that you can just flip open to these different cards, which have on them different aircraft and sort of how to start them and how to fly them. And one of the things I get accused of in Codename Verity is a lot of people say, oh, it's so full of technical details. it is true that I did include some like names of aircraft, because this book about pilot. So
True. What can I say?
It's a book about pilot. But I actually spent, this is a pilot's notes for Lysander. And this is also a facsimile. It's not the real thing, but it looks like the real thing. And I spent an awful lot of time sitting here looking at.
Oh, amazing.
The picture of the cockpit so that I could, trying to figure out how to start the thing. Ending, I was flying and sitting there like, okay, do this. But I also visited museums and went and looked at the aircraft that were involved in Codename Verity. And a lot of it I just set in places that I knew. So one of the characters is Maddie is from Stockport, and that's because I used to live not far from there, and I know people there, and her house is sort of based on a really good friend's house. And people say write about what you know. I don't think that should be something that you can only write about what you know, but it really helps if you bring valid details from your own experience.
I like the variation that is know what you write. That's a good variation.
That's a really good variation. And relevant to me, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, precisely. You mentioned that you decided to focus on the female friendships in these books. Mm-hmm. And you also focus a lot on flawed characters who still stay strong despite all the adversities they go through. Is this a conscious theme? It's something you wanted to write about?
I don't think it is a conscious theme that the characters are flawed. I think one of the things it sort of goes the other way as well. I'm incapable of creating a straightforward villain. Every time I try, they start sprouting like daughters and literary interests. And You know, there's, and honestly, every time I try to create a villain, I end up like coming to some scene where I have to go, okay, well, what is really driving this person now? What are they thinking? And when I put myself in their head, my whole perspective on them changes. And I think that's why my realistic characters and my sympathetic characters end up flawed as well. Have you actually read the Winter Prince?
Not yet, no, because I couldn't get my hands on it.
The character in the Winter Prince, this one, the first book, is a really nasty character. The narrator of the Winter Prince is not supposed to be the hero of the book. Mm-hmm. He is nasty, but he's really sympathetic. So that whole, you know, delving into somebody's background and figuring out what makes them tick and trying to make them into a better person despite their flaws is definitely something that I've always done. I wouldn't say it's meant to be a theme, except that I think I really like my characters to be realistic, and we are all flawed.
Yes, of course. We've touched on this a little bit, but your books have a natural diversity because of their settings and their locations. What do you think is lacking in terms of diversity in today's YA's market?
Oh, that's such a dangerous question.
And it's complicated. I know it's complicated, but are a lot of things lacking, and there are a lot of good people trying and making it better, definitely. But you know,
my professional opinion is, can I just tear my hair out? What really bothers me the most, I think, is a tendency to put different genders into compartments. Okay, and actually, you could extend that to race and religion. I feel like the whole diversity argument is starting to compartmentalize everything, and people are aware of this. And so, one way they try to do it is to write a book that's just about a certain type of person, and there's no other kind of people in the book, because it's not supposed to be about anybody else. And another way that people try to deal with it is they try to have a different character of you know, all kinds of different types, some representative person for, you know, five different races, five different colors, five different sexual orientations, and so that everybody is represented. And I feel like this conscious let's try to broaden everybody's mind is maybe, I don't know, it's maybe not realistic. And I notice it. I notice it when I read a book that has, like, you know, sort of a gang of kids that are, you know, very, very well mixed. I mean, it's lovely, but it just feels sort of forced. And I don't know how you get around that. Okay? I don't know how you get around that, because setting a book in Britain, I have been working on a story which is set in a more modern Britain, and it's so hard to bring diversity into it because there isn't any, you know, in the time period that I'm writing about, there isn't any. And it bugs me. Kind of wishy-washy answer. So I haven't said, you know, oh, we need more books about.
No, because it's complicated. I know it's a hard question because it's complicated. Any nuances about it?
I have been very much aware in the book that I've been working on that it's a problem. I was born in New York City. My father was Jewish. My mother was the daughter of a Protestant minister. And we spent 2 years, I started school in England, we then moved to Jamaica for 3 years. So I didn't come to the United States till I was nine. And during the years that we lived in Jamaica, there was just like, I mean, everybody was everything. And you kind of didn't, I didn't, as a seven-year-old, notice. I really didn't notice. Mm-hmm. My mother's best friend lived with us, and she was Jamaican, and her son was Jamaican, and my parents adopted a biracial kid at the time. Which, I mean, at the time, they adopted a biracial kid. Not biracial. and it wasn't anything we thought about. It wasn't anything I thought about. And when I came to the United States in 1973, when I was 9 years old, I went to a school in Harrisburg that was mostly Black. And I was like one of maybe two white kids in my class. And everybody thought that I was Hispanic because I spoke with this weird accent because I'd just come from Jamaica. Mm-hmm. And I don't know really what was going on. I never entirely understood what was going on at the time because I'd never experienced any kind of racial prejudice. But I was really vilified. And I don't know if that's because I was white or because they thought I was from Puerto Rico, because I wasn't, or if they thought that I was just intellectual weirdo, which I was. but I had a hard time with the kids there, and I was baffled by it, absolutely baffled by it. So I'd be walking home from school, and people would come along and just beat me up. I'd go home and I'd have a black eye. I didn't know why, you know? So this was kind of my introduction to the United States. And I still kind of look back on that time and try to understand the cultural perspectives that were going on there. It was just at the end of the civil rights movement in the United States. You know, so these kids that I was going to school with, their parents, you know, if they'd come from anywhere in the South, they wouldn't have been able, until they were adults, to share drinking fountains or ride buses, you know, get the proper seats, get the seats in the front of buses or sit at a table in a restaurant with white people. You know, maybe that's part of what was going on. But I didn't have a clue. Absolutely didn't have a clue. And I don't think it damaged me. I think it was a wake up call that, you know, my life was not the happy little Garden of Eden that I'd lived in Jamaica, where my friends were multicolored and of religions. I mean, I didn't even know what their religions were, but they were all religions. And it made me more aware, I think. Mm-hmm. Made me more aware. And I think that does show in my books. I think I do try to be aware. I know that I fail in some cases. I have a hard time coming up with kind of the next stage. You know, where am I going as a writer? How am I going to approach this? What am I going to write about? And how am I going to make diversity part of the issue? Because a lot of times the story I have to tell, it's kind of like in the background, but it feels like it's more important than that now. It needs to be foregrounded.
Mm-hmm. Way to bring attention to it in terms of the market and the industry is to focus on own voices books. I don't know if you know the hashtag. on voices, meaning writers that write about characters that are in the same situation as them. So
right.
LGBTQA writers yeah. writing about characters. Because one thing you notice a lot now is there are more diverse characters, but the writers
yes,
the
true.
Writers aren't diverse like the characters. I think
yeah.
we need to focus more on the writers as well and give them a chance to show their work.
Yeah.
Because they're
yeah.
amazing as
but
well.
Then, I mean, that's something that really, it's a matter of training people and to, you know, want to become writers, basically.
Give them more opportunities.
It would be great if everybody, you know, who had a different story to tell, told that story for us. But they're not all telling that story for us. And if you want me to speak in my own voice, well, I'm a 51-year-old white woman, mm-hmm. you know, and globally quite a wealthy woman, you know, compared to most of the rest of the population of the world. And that limits me mm-hmm. to say that I need to tell my story. It's like, you know, nobody wants to hear that. We've heard that a million times. The profile, the sort of background profile for children's book writers is white woman born in New York City.
Exactly. Like, we need to change that. And some of us can change that by talking about it, you know, calling attention to it. Because there are writers out there writing about these things, so they need the industry's attention.
They totally get ignored. And
sure.
I'm actually, it's one of the things that really irritates me, because I know some people, you know, some of my friends who are writers are really doing a good job of writing about some of this stuff. And mm-hmm. their books are just, they're a little bit under the radar, you know,
yeah.
they're not getting the attention, they're not getting foregrounded. And it's frustrating, and I see this happening, and I think, well, you know, you're complaining because you can't find a book about a person who, you can't find a book about a middle-class black girl who's not unhappy or who's not fussing about her standing in her class or something like that. And I'm like, well, yeah, I can actually name, you know, three for you published in the last 5 years. But do you know what they are? So that kind of thing I find quite frustrating. And actually, to tell the truth, the books that I read when I was growing up, they were a diverse bunch of books. There was stuff out there
mm-hmm.
that was not strictly about the white middle class. And so like in fantasy, the Earthsea books by Ursula Le Guin, mm-hmm. all dark-skinned people, and I never pictured them as white, ever. And the copies of the books that I had, they weren't white on the copies of those books published in the 1970s. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like, okay, so why are they now?
True. What,
you know, did we go backwards there or what? Okay, I'm not going to spout a whole list of these books, mm-hmm. but I can put together a list if people are interested.
Sure.
But, you know, Zeely I won't go into a list of them now because I won't remember everybody's names and I would need to sit
down. You can share the list later and I'll publish it.
Yeah, that would be good. But so these were books that I read growing up. I'll put together, it will be a list of books that I read growing up.
Okay.
That were culturally diverse. Yeah, and which I feel kind of, you know, still should be read. They were books I loved. So mm-hmm. I don't know, do you count things like The Horse Without a Head, which was French, and it was about a group of kids. Yeah, it counts because they basically had no money whatsoever. and they had a Hispanic kid and a black kid in their gang as well. This book was published in like 1952.
Yeah, things have changed and maybe not for the best sometimes, you know. So we're trying to change them again for
I know. Yeah. This is what bugged me about Codename. The whole thing that was going on with writing feminist books is like, we were going along so well. Things were changing. I thought I could do anything. Yeah. Why have things turned around so badly?
I don't know.
Why are we still fighting over this stuff?
There's another thing about the YA market that from time to time, there's someone who says that YA is not quality literature, that books are just stories. Seeing as you write for a younger audience, what are your thoughts on this?
Well, I think that my books are quality literature. So, it's just garbage. I every time I hear somebody say something like that, I it's clickbait. I don't give it the time of day. I sometimes think that people just say these things so they can watch the whole YA community go. But there's fantastic literature out there. It's, you know, being produced every year by a huge number of people. I feel, as a writer, I feel that the bar is just constantly being raised. I actually find it kind of depressing. You know, things like The Lie Tree by Frances Harding. It's, how do I ever come up to that? Of Philip Pullman's books. My friend, the woman I had in mind actually earlier, Tanita Davis, who is not somebody loads of people have heard of. She just writes such lovely, carefully put together books about, you know, very, very realistic people. And actually her World War II book, Khmer's War, about her grandmother, who is in the first Black women's regiment in the United States. That's a fantastic book. So the accusation that they're not quality literature is just coming from people who haven't read any. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just garbage.
And like you said, books are so important for us growing up. So YAs is exactly that. So important for kids and even young adults and adults read them, you know?
I recently read M.T. Anderson's Symphony for the City of the Dead, which is about, it's about Shostakovich and it's about the siege of Leningrad. And it's such a fantastic book. It's really dense. It's about Shostakovich, the composer, and the siege of Leningrad, both together.
I had to study Shostakovich. I'm a musician, so.
Okay.
There's the cello over there.
Oh my gosh. It makes it so accessible that as I was reading this book, I thought, why does anybody bother to read any kind of nonfiction that's not written for young adults, because this is what I want to read, you know, something that's dealing with a real issue and is actually interesting and enjoyable. So I'm all over YA. I think it's great.
I agree. Talking about YA, but moving on to another industry, Is there interest in the film industry about Codename Verity? Is there anything there you can tell us about?
Sorry, you said in the film industry.
Film industry, yes.
I can't really tell you.
Okay.
More than you probably know from my Goodreads account.
Exactly. I saw the question there, and then maybe.
There's interest. It's under option.
Okay.
So. Yeah, watch this space, but don't hold your breath.
Okay. Assuming there'd be something, is there anyone you'd like to direct it? Or
these are the kind of questions that I'm just like not allowed to answer.
Okay. Actors and actresses, you can say nothing about that?
Careless talk costs lives.
Yeah, okay. I understand. Then I'm going to ask you the question I told you about. Is there something you'd like to write about someday, one day, historic era, character, anything?
Oh boy, you've now made that much more open than I imagined. There are lots of things I would like to write about.
One idea or one character.
I do you know what I would really like to do? Remember I told you the book that I wrote when I was 11 was a time travel story? I would like to write a time travel story. And I kind of have an idea for one, which has got a World War II setting as well. Mm-hmm. So that's something that's kind of cooking in the back of my head. I'd like to do something environmental. I'd like to do something that had a bit of a focus on environmental issues, which makes it sound like I want to write nonfiction. but I was thinking more like...
No, I understand.
Some kind of fantastic fable, mm-hmm. or something. That's something that I feel sort of strongly about. Maybe something to do with birds. combine the flying.
Something to do with birds.
Yes. Something to do with birds. Kill me will be aware that I'm kind of obsessed with an osprey that nests every year not far from where I live. Mm-hmm. And I've thought about, you know, people write books with bats as the main character, or rabbits as the main character. Maybe I could write a book about an osprey. Wouldn't that be good?
You could. Totally could. Yeah. I have some questions here that I got from people on Twitter and mm-hmm. my friends. They ask if you have a writing process, something you do, a specific place you need to write, time of day.
No. No.
No.
Unfortunately not. I wish I did. I do find that if I'm really stuck, if I leave the house, that helps. I also find that I like to work in my kitchen almost more than anywhere else,
okay.
Which is stupid because it doesn't have the best view and it's not the warmest room in the house. And mm-hmm. and it doesn't have the most comfortable chairs, but yeah, that's where I tend to like to write.
Mm-hmm. And do you have any favorite or influencing books? And movies, music, other media, even comic books.
Yes to all of that. And I'm aware that I've actually, I spent a lot of time talking about my early writing, and I could probably spend just as much time telling you about all my favorite books.
I understand.
Alan Garner, my battery is running low. I'm going to move so I can plug. I'm going to move so I can actually plug this in. So there will be a bit more glare.
No problem.
But at least my battery won't die. Alan Garner, who wrote, I'm not sure what would know him for. He is a British children's book writer, fantasy writer. His first two books are The Weird Stone of Brisingham and The Moon of Gomrath. And then he wrote a book called Elidor and the Owl Service. Mm-hmm. He produces very slowly. And I know the one that Americans will probably know is The Stone Book Quartet. Or not probably, but they might know it. And he set a lot of his books in the area where we lived when we lived in England. And he was kind of just starting out on his career when we lived there. And so this was before I could read. My father read his books mm-hmm. out loud to us. And he has always been with me as an influence. The Winter Prince was set in the same area. So he has been a huge influence on me. T.S. Eliot, the poet, a lot of his poetry kind of permeates a lot of the things I write. There are references to it, oblique references to it, in Codename Verity, in a lot of the Arthurian books as well. And all the great fantasists of the mid-20th century, because that's what I loved to read when I was younger. I find that Tolkien was like a huge, huge influence on me. And that some of the rhythms of his language kind of still direct me. Trying to think of more recently, Anne Morrow Lindbergh, who was Charles Lindbergh's wife, and was herself a pilot. And she wrote a lot of books about her early flying with Lindbergh, but also she kept a lot of diaries, which she then published over a series of kind of 50 years. I might be making that up. It might be less time than that. So it was less time. More like 15 years. Okay. So it's like okay. The diaries that she kept from before, just before she was married to after her children were born. And she has been a great influence in my life, both as a writer and as a pilot. Her best known book is probably Gift from the Sea, which is a very, very slender, and it's sitting on my desk, a very slender inspirational volume. There it is, Gift from the Sea, which I do, and that's how little it is. It's very big. And I keep that on my desk because every now and then I pick it up and start rereading it. It's all about sort of like how to kind of, you know, let go of all the little day-to-day things that you're getting hung up about and focus on being creative. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's a good book for inspiration.
I probably should read that.
You know, the last time I read it, I thought, and this is, again, talking about diversity, I thought, oh my God, this is like a white middle-aged woman. Be fair to her, that's what she was when she wrote it, sure. You know? Mm-hmm. But it really is, she's talking about her marriage, she's talking about her heterosexual relationship, she's mm-hmm. talking about her dishwasher and, you know, the distractions of taking her children to their various activities. And it really, for the first time, and I've read this book many, many times over the past 20 years, and for the first time I read it and I just thought, oh my goodness, you know, this is not going to be relevant to everybody. And I hope that people mm-hmm. can kind of, who read it and feel like it's not talking about them, cause it's not, but I hope that people can kind of still read it and feel that it's talking to them, that they can sort of get past that and realize that her message of make time for yourself, mm-hmm. Make time for your friends, make time for the person you love, you know, don't get hung up on the details, that all this stuff is still relevant, you know, even yes. if a particular personal situation isn't. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. What about movies or
movies? Comic books? Star Wars.
Star Wars? Did you say Star Wars?
Yes, I did. People always say, where do you get your ideas? And I was like, oh, the best answer to that is Star Wars.
Let me show you something.
Look at Star Wars, the original. Oh my goodness.
Can you see it?
Yeah. So if you look at the original Star Wars, you know, Episode 4, A New Hope, mm-hmm. you look at that and you look at the opening sequence and you look at the relationship between like Darth Vader and Princess mm-hmm. Leia, and then you go look at Code Name Verity.
Okay. I never thought that compare Code Name Verity to Star Wars, but
that was like, are you kidding me? Because when I was 12, when I first saw Star Wars, the year it came out, I was in the middle of like making up this story about this, it was a World War II story about this girl who is working for the resistance and she's captured and she's tortured and she has this like, you know, sort of passive aggressive relationship with her captor. And when I saw Star Wars, I was just like, oh yay, she doesn't give away the codes. She doesn't, you know, and so yeah, she doesn't give away the codes.
and actually, the episode 7 actually touches a lot on what we've talked about. A female character at the center of the movie, a very feminist movie, diverse yep. movie, and yep. some people were mad about that, saying, oh, Star Wars isn't like this, and why not? You know, it's in a galaxy far away. Why can't a girl fight?
Do you know what? That I actually felt my complaints about it were more subtle than that. And this goes back to something we were talking about earlier as well, where I was saying I felt like people didn't go far enough. And I kind of felt that way about The Force Awakens. It's like, okay, they have this female character who's great and she does all this stuff, but she's, you know, she's what they call a kick-ass female character. And I didn't feel like she had as much depth as she ought to have. Or even the backstory that she ought to have. It's like, you know, okay, so how did she learn to fly the Millennium Falcon, you know?
It's a secret.
It's great, has that skill, but what is the force at work?
It's the same thing with her force powers, actually. Well, I can talk.
Come on. It's not good enough.
I know. And I hope they reveal more stuff about it. But
also, I mean, the same thing goes for the diversity in it. It's like you could just take that little extra bit farther, you know?
I think it was Disney being careful.
Yeah.
Because if it wasn't Disney, I think J.J. Abrams might have gone further.
Yeah.
But being a Disney movie, I think they were a bit careful. Because, you know, it's been confirmed there's going to be a gay character, for example. It's been confirmed. And a lot of people suspect it's Poe, but...
You know, but it bugs me!
It hasn't been mentioned anywhere!
No, this is what bugs me, that, like, we're going to confirm that there's a gay character. So, remember, in The Empire Strikes Back, Lando Calrissian turns up and he's black. It's not a big deal.
Yep.
He just...
Just give Poe a boyfriend!
Yeah. It's like, what, do we have to point this out to people?
Exactly.
Why can't it just be part of the story?
True. We'll see.
That's what bugs me.
Yeah.
That's what bugs me, that it has to be highlighted, that it can't just be, wow, this is a great story, and it happens to have a gay character in it, that it has to be like, right, we're going to have a gay character. We're going to make it, you know, we're going to tell the world that this is a thing that has to, this is a personal thing. And I feel that people will object to me saying it, but I just don't feel like we're advancing at all by sort of making these grand political statements about stuff. That why can't we just sort of naturally do it?
The thing is, people aren't naturally doing it, I think, especially in Hollywood. I think people sometimes need the words and the labels, because they're absolutely not. They need to identify the characters. They need to look, there's gay characters in Star Wars. Of course there is, because it's a huge galaxy. Why wouldn't there be?
Well, duh. It's so mainstream, and I've whinged on to my children so much about the Bechdel test that I now have my 16-year-old son now walks out of movie and he goes, boy, that didn't pass.
that's good.
Like, you know, came out of Jurassic Park and we were like,
yep,
there were no female characters who ever had a conversation unless you count the dinosaurs.
Exactly. Yeah.
Because the dinosaurs were all girls. And I was like, you know what? That really doesn't count.
Yep. It's the same thing with the Ghostbusters now, the new movie.
Yeah.
The fans are going, oh, why all female? I mean, why all male? Isn't it the same thing?
Look, you know, in Annie, the recent Annie, where everybody's going, how can you make Annie black? And it's like, Annie. You know, it's like, look at the character.
The same thing with the new Hermione in the Cursed Child
play.
It's the same thing. But, you know, Chuck Wendig wrote a Star Wars book, and it has a gay character.
Mm-hmm.
And
why
he received so much bad reviews because the book had a gay character. Why?
My father, my Jewish father, was also gay. He also was involved in his partner for many, many years until my father died, was black. So my father was just like, you know, diversity personified. Okay. I wrote a short story about my dad coming out to me when I was 16. And I just recently reread it, and I just kind of looking at it to see how it holds up against today's approach, because this story was published, in like 1994 or something like that. It was published a good 20 years ago. And it was, there were a couple of things in it where I just thought, wow, I was very old fashioned, you know, I was trying to be open-minded when I was 16 and didn't know what was going on. And these things were talked about a lot less than they are now.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's interesting. Actually, the other thing that interested me in reading this short story was that, and this has absolutely nothing to do with diversity, this has to do with the writer's craft. I'm not a fan of the first person present tense, which is currently the default way of writing a young adult novel. And this story is written in the first person present tense.
And there are 30 stories in the book. Two of them are in the first person present tense, and one of them is mine. And that was my, and I'd forgotten that I'd done that. So it was interesting to look at, because I've recently had a short story published. Yes, in this collection.
Oh yes, I need that so much. I want to read that so much, but I haven't bought it yet. But yes.
And I believe that almost that the ratio is actually now the other way around. That of the, I don't know how many, I can't remember how many stories are in it, but it looks like a dozen. I think only two of them are not written in the first person mm-hmm. present tense. And mine is one of them again. So constantly going against the grain. And it's interesting to see how that has changed. And I remember when I read The Hunger Games for the first time, I was really struck by the first person present, because it gave this immediacy to it. And you couldn't quite figure out whether or not they gave an urgency to it, because you couldn't figure out whether or not the main character was going to survive. Mm-hmm. And you kind of figured they must do, or like the story would end. But
I remember reading them, and I really liked the personal touch, because it works in my type of story.
But the thing is that I feel that kind of now it's so much the default that it loses some of its urgency, that it's expected that you do that.
I'm a literary agent intern, so I've been reading a lot of manuscripts, and there's still a lot of people writing in the third person, actually.
Are there?
Okay. Yes. Well, maybe not reaching the market. Yes. Well, that's
the thing. Are you reading books in English or in Portuguese?
English, yeah.
In English,
because
okay.
The Portuguese publishing industry is very, very different here. Okay. They barely publish any Portuguese author, for example. Wow. And young authors, nope.
That's really, really hard.
It's very different. We don't have agents at all. You submit directly to the publisher. They don't care a lot about science fiction or fantasy. They want the contemporary books written by famous people. That's basically it. Yeah. And then they translate a lot of the best-selling books from the UK, United States.
From your point of view, this makes the, you know, own voice hashtag so relevant.
True.
So, you know, it's like, okay, well, where are the books about young people like me in my own language?
True. There aren't. Nope.
Amazing.
There's like one or two publishers that publish fantasy and science fiction, but almost only translated books. No Portuguese writers.
So you will have to change that.
I've tried. I've written fantasy books in Portuguese, and no one wanted them.
Are young.
Are you? Yeah, well, yes. No. Yeah, but I have a lot of time to.
I got this all the time. It's like, oh yeah, so Codename Verity, you know, career breakthrough, you know, how did this happen? It's like, it took 20 years.
Mm-hmm, true.
20 years.
I think the problem here is books are very expensive.
Yeah.
So not a lot of people can buy them, and so books become more expensive, and it's a never-ending cycle. You can find Portuguese authors, and I can't relate to them or what they write.
So I'm sitting here boasting about all the various diverse books that I read as a child, but I did not read any by any Portuguese authors.
Probably not, no. Well, I don't want to take a lot of your time. I don't know if you want to add anything else about writing your books, about anything.
I feel like I should add some kind of inspirational word. I know what I was going to say earlier when I was talking about the Society for Children's Book Writers and Illustrators. I was actually going to put in a little plug for them. For anybody listening, and probably for you as well, if you're not already a member, the Society for Children's Book Writers and Illustrators is an international organization that
basically promotes writing and illustrating of children's books. You know, it does what it says on the box. But it is a fantastic way, if you were trying to break in to writing, to make those associations and networks that I was saying were so important to getting published. They have meetings all over the world. I don't know if there's a group in Portugal, but there probably is. There isn't.
Really? I don't think there is, no.
Okay, wait, I'm going to look for you while I continue to talk about them. If there isn't, that thing actually to think about setting up one yourself, because becoming a volunteer for them is in fact a fantastic way to get in on the inside track. Mm-hmm. And that is actually how I got most of my breaks, is really from volunteering for the SCBWI. And just it's a great way to talk to other people who are, you know, kind of doing the same thing. They give a lot of support. You're right, there's no Portuguese chapter. Yep. Which is really too bad. But there are chapters throughout Europe and throughout most of the world. It looks like they've got about 30 international chapters.
Yeah, the publishing industry and the book industry here is very, very small. So I suspect there might not be.
It's a really, really good way. Even if, honestly, when I first got together with them, I think the Swedish chapter had like 3 people who were involved. And basically what they did was they met in somebody's living room and had coffee, you know, every 6 months or something like that. It's just a way to talk to other people and to, you know, I've now lost my, oh, there we are, lost my Google Hangouts page, because I was going to stick in the comments. I was just going to stick the little link to the regional map there. I was saying, how do I stick a comment on this?
I'm not sure. Maybe you can send it to me and I'll add it to the description later.
I'll just send it to you. Yeah, I'll just send it to you. But Society for Children's Book Writers and Illustrators, even if you find that you can't join it locally, maybe somebody else who's listening will be able to mm-hmm. Join. But they have annual conferences in New York and Los Angeles. There are throughout Europe togethers. And even if you don't have a local group, it's a great way to find out resources about, you know, different publishers, different international publishers, agents, marketing, and just general support. And I will tell you the URL. It is scbwi.org.
Okay. I'll check it out.
scbwi.org. And I'll send you the link as well. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I think that's all for now. Thank you so much for this amazing interview, Elizabeth, really.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. And I'm really looking forward to the conference. I hope I get to sit in on it a little bit. I'm going to be traveling all day the first day that it's going on, and then I'm going to be staying at schools all the next day. But hopefully I'll be able to stop in and see what's happening.
And if you can't, all the panels will be recorded, so you can watch them later.
Okay. Fantastic.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Fantastic.
And thank you, everyone. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.